Okay, this is a situation that comes up sometimes. If you have to reset everything, some people think you've got to reinstall all the ICOM software again in order to get back to ground zero. But that isn't always the case. You can probably run into a situation like this and fix it very easily. See, here I have a radio. I've got a couple of them because I have two radios connected. But the delete button is grayed out. I can't delete it. And I don't have any servers in here, which I was able to get rid of those. So how do I get rid of the radios? Well, up here in the options button is where you can do it. So you go up here to local server settings. And now radio lists pop up. And when you highlight one, all of a sudden you have the ability to delete it. So I'm going to set this this server situation up with nothing in it to start with so I can show how you set up the server computer the first time. This is from scratch. So first I got to get rid of the radios. Yes, I'm sure. Takes it a second because there is actually a radio connected to my computer here. This is a laptop computer. So I'll go ahead and delete this one also. And it says, are you sure? And I go, yes. And now everything is gone. Now I'm going to pause the video here for a second. I'm going to go ahead and shut the server. I'm going to shut this window down. I'm going to shut down the server. There it goes. And I'm going to start up the ICOM remote utility again. The reason that I paused it is I don't want to be showing off the user or the disk information. I'm sure ICOM wouldn't appreciate it. Anyway, so you start this up again. First thing you're presented with is this setup wizard. Now, I used to think it was helpful, and I don't think it's helpful anymore because it's really not clear what all this stuff means to most of us. So let's get rid of that. And the objective here is to go ahead, you have two blank lists here. The objective here is to create a radio. Now the radios are connected to this computer, but this program doesn't know it yet. It actually does know it, but it hasn't connected to them. So I'm going to go up under here, and I'm going to say options, local server settings again, and I'm going to add a registered radio. So I say add. And it's going to look and says, oh, I found something, and would you like this radio to be accessible from other PCs or only this PC? Well, if we're setting up a client for a remote access, we want the server to allow it to connect. So this is a server situation. Yes, it's accessible from other PCs. So you pick that. Now, because this program knew your radios were connected, it actually has both of my radios here. It has one on COM4 and one on COM5. Now, because I have both radios hooked up, I can create a problem. But let's hope that I get the radios correct, because one radio is set to 7C and the other one is set to CIV 7 Delta D. And frankly, I don't remember which one's which. And the only way you're going to tell is when you're running the program for the first time, plug the radios in one at a time. Don't do what I did just now and have them both going at the same time. See, if you bring up the device manager, put that over here, you'll notice that in the ports, it says that I have two radios. They're both active, but one of them is on COM4, the other's on COM5, and I'm going to hope that I remember which one's which. I think the COM4 is the 7C and the COM5 is the 7D radio. If you get that wrong, it's going to fail. So let me suggest you do only one radio at a time. And when you add power to a radio, it immediately enables the USB port in the radio. So just turning it off is not enough. You may want to just unplug the USB cable if you have two radios or just have one. So let's say I'm going to pick the COM4 one first. And I found it automatically. If you have to go this route, you've made a mistake. So we're going to go this route. We have a radio that is controllable by the ICOM system. This is really for other transceivers that may use CIV or whatever it's going to use, but I don't use those for right now. So here we have COM4, so we can say next. Now, I'm going to assume that I got this right. This should be the 7C. The default is 94 for both radios, but I had to, obviously with two radios, got to have a different CIV address for one than the other. So I'm going to assume that I put 7C on the radio that's connected to this COM4 port. Now I do want to be 115.2 in order to make the scope work. So I say next, and I have a whole bunch of people that I've already pre-assigned here. But if you need to add a user, you hit the add, and you definitely add yourself. If you don't add yourself, I mean, it's kind of like, what's the point? So if your call sign is, W1AW, you might want to add that and then come down here and give it a password, Newington or something. Has to be at least 8 characters. So, and you can make it an admin or not. All my users are admins. But meanwhile, I've already got users. And once you have a user, say, like I have a new user here, all you need to do if you want to add them to the list of accessible users. So far, not assigned to any radio, just a list of potential users. Here's one of the advantages of the USB connection. I can have many, many users, registered users. On a 7610 or any LAN-operated radio, they're limited. They only think they only have 3. But you can run the 7610 as a USB radio if you have a second and third ICOM radio, and I think they can run up like 8 radios with this program. And you want to have multiple users allowed to use different radios. You might want to have more than just yourself and someone else. So anyway, now you do next. I have myself, and I have another test, and I have a fifth, and then I have my friend Rich, who he and I kind of started this group. Okay, next. Now the radio name here, I don't like this radio name because it doesn't tell me what it is. So I'm going to go change that to W6FCC. 7C, whoops, got to do it right, 7300. So I know the CIV port, I know the kind of radio it is, and I know whose radio it is. So I say next. The next thing it says is, well, it's going to do something with sound settings. I don't use this feature because I use everything as default. If I want to change where the radio is going to put out sound or where it's going to get sound, I do that in the computer that I'm using to access this program. I don't let ICOM decide where the sound is going. But if you did this, it's going to ask you these kinds of questions. Where are you? Where do you want the radio to go and everything? But since my speakers are the default device for playback and my microphone is the default device for, the modulation, I don't bother with this stuff, so you just say finish. Notice this, we have a radio. Now I could stop at this point, and I think I will, because most of you only have one radio. At this point I'm going to say I'm done. Now there's no server required, strangely enough, when you're running ICOM Remote as a server. This server list is when you're running ICOM Remote as a client, meaning you want to connect to a server somewhere else with this laptop. But this laptop serves only one purpose for me, and that's to be a server. So I'm not going to try to create a server or add a server or do anything like it. All I want is radios, and you notice this one says local, and it says it's connected to port 4, and it's a CIV. At this point, you leave this alone. You don't shut this down, and everything is ready to go, and I'm now going to stop at this point. This is W6FCC doing a recording.